Hello, friends of human spaceflight, and welcome to another week in review as we take a closer look at the space industry and launch into space news from around the world. Coming up, trouble ahead for the BE-4 as Blue Origin reports an explosion. China launches the first methane-fueled rocket into orbit. Electron takes to the skies and we celebrate the first anniversary of the James Webb Space Telescope with a stunning new image. Stay tuned because there's lots ahead. Let's get stuck in. In huge news this week, Beijing's private spaceflight company, LandSpace, made spaceflight history when they beat their US competitors in launching the first ever methane rocket into space. Taking off from the Jiuquan Satellite Launch Center in the Gobi Desert, Jiuquan-2, which translates to Vermilion Bird 2, tore through the skies at 9 p.m. local time, beating SpaceX, ULA, Blue Origin, and others to the punch. This is also the second successful launch of a liquid propellant rocket by a Chinese company, highlighting the country's dedication to developing their commercial space launch efforts. The US Space Force confirmed the 49.2-meter rocket reached sun-synchronous orbit, and although no payloads were on board, it was a huge success for the company and showcased LandSpace's dedication despite setbacks with their previous attempt, which ended in failure in December last year. Methane-fueled rockets are ideal for reusability and are a cheap and safe alternative, creating less pollution than their alternatives. With assembly of a third launch vehicle already underway, LandSpace aims to put a second methane-fueled rocket into orbit by the end of the year and has stated that they will begin mass production now they have confirmation their design is effective. We will certainly keep you updated as the next mission progresses. Spectators were treated to quite the show this week with Rocket Lab's Baby Come Back mission on Tuesday the 18th of July, taking to the skies from LC-1B over New Zealand's Mahia Peninsula. This was the 7th Electron launch this year and 39th overall. The payloads for this mission included 7 satellites, 4 for NASA's Starlink CubeSat mission, 2 Spire Global 3U satellites, and a Telesat LEO 3 spaceflight laboratory satellite. The Starlink mission aims to enable future launch of multiple autonomously coordinated spacecraft to prove capabilities and technology for in-space network communications, navigations, maneuverability, and execution. This will be a huge milestone for future scientific research missions. Imagine a drone show that uses swarms of robots communicating with each other in a low Earth orbit. Spire's 2 3U satellites carried Global Navigation Satellite System radio occultation payloads, which will be used to update its current 100 satellite strong constellation. Their low Earth multi-use receiver boasts a suite of sensors that support maritime and aviation data, as well as monitor weather on Earth. Spaceflight Laboratory's Telesat mission aboard Electron includes LEO 3, a demo satellite that improves reliability for its customers following decommission of their Phase 1 LEO satellite. This mission bolsters the company's vision of being the world's most advanced low Earth orbit constellation supporting maritime, aeronautical, and government data. Following orbital insertion, Electron's booster splashed down in the Pacific Ocean before being retrieved and transported back to the production site. For this mission, Rocket Lab used an improved lightweight parachute system for booster recovery, and this was the first mission in which a two-point lifting method was used to recover Electron's first stage from the sea. Recent modifications mean recovery Electrons are specifically designed to withstand time in the ocean, including better sealing of the interstage, power pack, and internal units of the Rutherford engines. Rocket Lab's dedication to reusability has led Electron through an evolutionary process, and later this year, the company reports they will attempt to refly a recovered engine for the first time.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to my latest segment here on To the Future. Time to cut loose on my favorite chew toy, Blue Origin. Just when we thought we had heard all the jokes about Jeff Bezos's BE-4 engines, a new wave of criticism hit this week when Blue Origin reported that there had been an explosion at their West Texas facility on June 30th. The company was conducting a test fire of their notoriously frustrating BE-4 engine for ULA Cert 2 flight when it unexpectedly exploded approximately 10 seconds into the test. Luckily, no employees were injured during the event, but this is no doubt a devastating blow for the company, who are expected to produce the low-cost, high-performance engines for the highly anticipated Vulcan fleet. With major setbacks arising early on and Vulcan's inaugural launch slipping further away, one can't help but wonder if we will ever see it take to the skies. The explosion occurred only 6 days after ULA announced their Vulcan rocket's upper stage Centaur V would be returning to their factory in Decatur, Alabama, after suffering its own explosion on March 29th. An investigation revealed a hydrogen leak from Centaur ignited after building up within the test stand, with catastrophic results. The team is working tirelessly to reinforce the top of the forward dome so that the Vulcan Cert 1 flight can get back on track. As of this month, Tory Bruno made it clear that he expects to see Vulcan back on the pad with all testing complete in the fourth quarter of this year. But whether or not news of the BE-4 explosion at Blue Origin derails their efforts again is yet to be seen. We have heard the minor setback song and dance many times before from Bruno. A fourth quarter launch seems unlikely at best, but we will see how all of this plays out. We will, of course, bring you all the latest on the highly anticipated Vulcan launch and the fate of the BE-4s as we learn more. Back to you.
In exciting news for the India Space Research Organization, the launch of lunar mission Chandrayaan III got underway on the 13th of July from Satish Dhawan Space Center in India. Carried by their medium lift rocket launch vehicle Mark III, the mission will see India land on the lunar surface near the end of August to carry out experiments and test their rover at the lunar south pole. A propulsion module will transport the lander and a 26-kilogram rover into lunar orbit before the lander touches down on the lunar surface, guided by onboard hazard detection technology and avoidance cameras, an upgrade from the Chandrayaan 2 mission to the moon that Israel launched in 2019. Upon successful landing, it will conduct experiments and collect data for 14 days, the equivalent of one day on the moon. Israel has built upon lessons learned from their previous two missions, and the lunar lander for the Chandrayaan 3 mission boasts some exciting scientific advancements. An instrument for lunar seismic activity, or ILSA for short, will detect potential moonquakes, while NASA's laser retroreflector array will measure distances on the surface. Surface temperature and thermal conductivity will be monitored by Chandra's Surface Thermophysical Experiment, or CHEST, and the Langmuir probe will investigate plasma found in the lunar atmosphere. An alpha particle X-ray spectrometer aboard the mission's lunar rover will provide data for scientists to research elements contained within moon rocks and regolith, and a laser-induced breakdown spectroscope will investigate the composition of the lunar surface in greater depth. I think it's safe to say we can expect to learn a lot from this mission, and we are excited to bring you the latest as we get closer to the Chandrayaan 3 lunar landing later next month. This week, we celebrated the first anniversary of unfolding the universe with the James Webb Space Telescope. A special image revealed to mark the occasion on Wednesday shows around 50 young stars enrobed in a stunning cloud of gas and space dust. Depicted in stunning clarity, the image was captured from approximately 390 light years away and is the nearest star-forming region to Earth. It has been an incredible first year of operation for the James Webb Space Telescope, which has brought us some of the most incredible images we have ever seen. It has brought together scientists from around the world to help us unravel the mysteries of the universe. It has paved the way for NASA to lead us in a new era of discovery and has succeeded in shedding light on the far recesses of the universe. The data retrieved from telescope spectroscopic instruments has helped experts map some of the farthest galaxies ever observed and discover the oldest and most distant supermassive black holes. We know more than ever about the makeup of planetary atmospheres and have a better understanding of the chemical composition of gas giants and the formation of our own home planet. We look forward to all that is yet to come from JWST. And now for something a little different. For the first time in human history, scientists have alluded to the Anthropocene epoch, a new geological time period in which humanity has undeniably and irreversibly affected planet Earth. Think of it as the way sedimentary rock contains multiple layers, each representing a specific period in time. Although humans have been roaming, farming, and developing the planet for roughly 6 million years, people from different parts of the world have not been working at the same rate, and humanity's contributions on the Earth have gone unrecorded in Earth's geological layers. That is, until now. Experts have discovered that an undeniable mark of humanity's existence appears in Earth's sedimentary layer, starting from the 1950s, and appears consistently across the globe. Humanity's contribution to this geological layer of our home planet is quite different from the other layers of sediment the Earth's crust is composed of. Our timestamp is in the form of the radioactive element plutonium, which humans have harnessed in modern times for the development of nuclear weapons. Although other signs of humanity's impact on the planet can be seen, including increased consumption of fossil fuels, the greater use of nitrogen fertilizers, and an increase in trade that has resulted in the spread of plant and animal life across the planet, scientists have reported the plutonium marker in Earth's sediment presents the first definite boundary of humanity's existence. The Anthropocene Working Group, or AWG, have declared 24-meter deep Crawford Lake near Toronto, Canada, as the official global monitoring site for this important timestamp in human history. Experts claim the isolation of the bottom of the lake is the ideal environment for recording changes to the planet over the course of human history. I think we can all agree it's great to see humanity woven into the fabric of our home planet. Breaking news just in as we're recording this. Unfortunately, JAXA's Epsilon engine test suffered an anomaly around 57 seconds into the test. Be sure to tune in next week whilst our team here at 2TF digs into this breaking story. Well, that's all for this week's Journey Through Space, and we hope you enjoyed this episode. We'll be back next week with a fresh selection of hand-picked news as we bring you the latest developments throughout the industry and some fun along the way. Thanks for watching, and as always, onwards to the future.